we're looking at a team that has no identity. They are very young, and the NBA is continuing to cheat their fans out of the money, out of the hard-earned money, by picking young guys who cannot play basketball. They can just hoop. And that's just the name of that tune, man. The Atlanta Hawks are not a team that's to be respected because they don't have enough talent. And I keep asking you guys, how is it that in the NBA, at one point, the Eastern Conference had just about an all-star. The Brooklyn Nets had an all-star. Well, they were New Jersey Nets. The Nets had an all-star. The Knicks had all-stars. The Raptors didn't exist. The Bulls had Michael Jordan. Cleveland had three all-stars. The Pistons had two or three all-stars. The Pacers had one or two all-stars. The Bucks had one or two all-stars. Even the Hawks back in the day, the Heat didn't exist. The Atlanta Magic didn't exist. The Wizards, they had Moses Malone. And the Hornets didn't exist. But most of those teams had two to three all-star caliber players. And now you don't even have a lot of these dudes not even NBA worthy. Where is, and that which brings me to the question, where's the middle class in basketball? But with that being said, the Atlanta Hawks won't expect much. And then we're talking about 20-25 games, and it's a wrap for them. The next team on the bottom of the totem pole is the Charlotte Hornets. This is a team that's run by Michael Jeffrey Jordan, everybody's favorite basketball player, arguably the greatest player of all time, and for whatever reason, they cannot get things in order. Now, the good thing about them is this. They do have some talent on this team. They were ravaged by injuries, so we don't know what really to expect. You got Kemba Walker, great point guard out of the University of Connecticut. They may be moving him. You got Marvin Williams, a power forward, 6'9" power forward out of the University of North Carolina. Solid ball player. Cody Zeller, solid ball player. You got Tony Parker, former champion, who getting that last big check before he kick rocks and flip-flops. Jeremy Lamb, solid ball player out of the University of Connecticut. Michael Kidd-Gilchrist, perfect example of a guy who needed to stay in school and hone his craft. Now, what I am impressed with is Miles Bridges, the re-acquisition of Bismarck Biyombo. Hopefully Nicholas Batum could stay healthy. And Malik Monk should have a better year after his abysmal rookie year. He can still shoot the ball. It's going to be interesting, to say the least. Hopefully they can stay healthy, and they should be right around 500 or whatever. It's going to be an interesting season in Charlotte, but the Hornets, you can expect potentially 500, but not a whole lot. Hopefully, Jordan them, they have a plan at this point. It looks like they playing Xbox or something out there out east of Charlotte. But hopefully, Jordan has finally got his act together. He hired Mitch Kupchak. They are getting things. Hopefully, they're getting things in order. I picked them. I finished higher than the next team I'm gonna cover, which is the Orlando Magic. Again, a perfect example of how the hell is this team even in the NBA? You got Aaron Gordon, 6'9" power forward, doing this thing. They just gave him a little chop to stay. Outside of that, they don't have a whole lot of talent on this roster. It's just not a whole lot of talent. And look, you still got Aaron to follow on this team for UCLA. DJ Augustine. You do have Mo Bamba, a dude who looks like he can make a difference. But again, Mo Bamba is still actually learning basketball. Jaren Grant, another guy who is just a role player. He out of Notre Dame. I like Jaren Grant, but these are not difference makers. Jonathan Simmons from the Spurs, he's scrappy. It's just, man, this is a team full of guys who are just guys. They are simply just guys. When you have a combination of this many guys who haven't made an impact in the league, you got Jared Vanderbilt, freshman out of Kentucky. I think Jared Vanderbilt is going to be solid, but he's just sad. You got too many people on the team and on the floor that there is too much uncertainty when it comes to the Orlando Magic. I do predict that the Hornets will finish in front of them. I don't know why I picked them next, but yeah. But again, they are a pitch. They are a mirror of the Atlanta Hawks, and they should be second to last in this division, or last. They should be tied with the Atlanta with the Atlanta Hawks. It should be them, the Atlanta Hawks, and whoever else. Then I will go with the Charlotte Hornets. The next team I'm going to look at is the Washington Wizards. The Washington Wizards are a conundrum. They have enough talent to be good. But for whatever reason, these dudes cannot get their act together. You got guys who are uber sensitive about, you know, all the time I've been in sports, it's been a next man up mentality. You get hurt, we doing it this way, we doing it that way. These guys are getting upset. They're getting angry. They're throwing rocks at each other. They're talking crazy to each other. And we're just in a situation to whereas it is a chaotic situation in Washington. And I don't know why. You have the likes of Bradley Beal. You have the likes of the newly acquired Dwight Howard, who, from my perspective, has to be a locker room cancer. And it's tough to call somebody a locker room cancer when you have the talent of Dwight Howard, but he has to be that, because look at it this way. Dwight Howard was run out, from what I understand, when Dwight Howard was traded out of Atlanta, his hometown Atlanta Hawks team, teammates stood up and clapped in the locker room. Then, when that happened, he goes to Charlotte. He gets to Charlotte, teammates hate him again. Now, I'm not saying that whoever likes you in the locker room is a reflection of who you actually are. That's not what I'm saying. But if you can't get along with anybody, maybe it is you, bro. But this is already a toxic locker room. So you're forced to wonder what's going on. What really helps me think that this can be saved is because even though John Wall went down, people like Otto Porter Jr. stepped up. You got Ty Lawson on his basketball team. Ty Lawson is 30 years old. He has substance abuse issues. Hopefully he's worked through that and it's going to be a better situation. You got another guy who's a veteran leader in Jeff Green. Jeff Green is wildly inconsistent, but put in the right situation, he can be effective. As aforementioned Bradley Beal, the aforementioned John Wall, and when you got Jody Meeks for shooting purposes, adding Dwight Howard to this mix, as well as Austin Rivers, you have the potential to have way too many people on this damn team for one, but the potential to have a solid nucleus of veterans and a combination of veteran and a veteran nucleus and young guys in the mix, and if they can get the right mix on the floor, this could be a very solid basketball team. I don't think they're going to ever contend for a title until they get the right leadership, for one, and the right mix of veterans and rookies, or veteran and young guys. This is why I keep saying, I've been saying this for a year, there is no middle class in sports anymore, because just because you're eligible for a max deal does not mean you should get a max deal. And we have gotten to the point in sports to where as we're going to lose him, so we have to pay him the most. Not in accordance to what he's done, in accordance to what you might do. And I'm not paying you something that you might do, because most people don't do what they might do, they're supposed to do. And that's how you end up getting cheated. This leads us to the Miami Heat. Now, we're hearing rumors throughout the NBA lexicon that the Miami Heat are on a in the conversation of getting Jimmy Butler. Now, we know that more than likely homies Wade got a lot to do with that. And Jimmy Butler is a perfect example of the lack of middle class. Jimmy Butler is not the type of guy that the whole world needs to be speaking about when we're talking about best players in the league, because Jimmy Butler is not that. Jimmy Butler is not on my list. I started off at 16 and got down to 12. Jimmy Butler is not 12 in between 12 and 1, because you cannot build a franchise around Jimmy Butler. I don't know how he got in that conversation. I don't know what makes him or the people who run this team believe that he should be in this conversation. But what we're going to do is look at the situation in Miami. They are overpaying way too many people. The Miami Heat, I don't get this team. Pat Riley's supposed to be one of the premier people with personnel and putting things together. They are going to, this is a perpetual middle of the road team. Goran Dragic, 32 years old. I think he got like two or three more years. They got Wayne Ellington, 30 years old. Udonis Haslem, 38. James Johnson, 31. Tyler Johnson, 26. They got too many guys. Again, they have too many guys that are just guys. This is where you need a guy who's going to be your go-to guy. They thought they had that from the University of Marshall. 7-foot guy. He's athletic. He hits free throws. Hassan Whiteside. But this dude can't focus. Then you got Justin Winslow. Everybody was breaking their neck to get to this guy. And he's just not panned out. Again, let these guys stay in school to hone their craft. And then start picking and paying them this money. Otherwise, you're going to get a bunch of guys who are also Rams. And they are not going to be exactly what you're looking for. And the Miami Heat are experiencing that. I don't see where Jimmy Butler fits in this mix. And I don't understand why you need him there. You already got a Jimmy Butler and a Deion Waiters. You already got a Jimmy Butler and a Justin Winslow. You already got Joshua. It's a team full of dudes who are just under Jimmy Butler or right at Jimmy Butler status. So add Jimmy Butler to this team does absolutely nothing if you ask me. But it looks as if nobody's asking me. And the Miami Heat are in the Jimmy Butler sweepstakes. For what reason, I don't know. Maybe they're trying to go work on bringing Kyrie Irving or one of those guys that we're going to see. And with that being said, we're coming up at the top of the hour. I'm going to give you a 4-minute break. We're going to start off with a music break. One of the best songs. One of the songs of the 90s that I really enjoy. I'll let your boy. I'm going to get at you in 4 minutes, 19 seconds. It's the end of the Bench Podcast. Enjoy.
Yeah, we were getting down and scaring the rest. Yo, I even had to wear the bulletproof. fuck.